The prison is a call of comfort and another year to live.
Hello, my name is Carlo.
And I'm Madeline.
And we are here to represent Rock University High School from Janesville, Wisconsin in the United States. Our presentation is a website that you can also visit. It is named #safe.weebly.com.
We would like to start our presentation with a video showcasing the thoughts of two professors in the University of Wisconsin, Rock County.
I think a helpful way that we can use nuclear energy is, of course, for power. And so we can generate a lot of electricity from nuclear energy. And in fact, we do that all over the world right now successfully. So I think that that's a strength of nuclear energy. That said, of course, there are a lot of disadvantages. And, you know, we've seen at the Fukushima power plant, one of the disadvantages was the accidental release of radiation into the ocean and into the communities surrounding Japan. So as we look at those kinds of accidents that can happen, that's a definite downside.
The bombs we have today are hydrogen bombs. Hydrogen bombs use Nagasaki bombs as triggers. That kind of destructive power does not discriminate. The weapons are so big and useless. They are genuinely useless. And why we have so many of them is an interesting thing. You can't use them. You know, if you do, you've lost.
In my lifetime in the United States, I'm not. But I don't have any faith that that wouldn't happen around the world somewhere else.
Absolutely. You'd have to be foolish not to be. These weapons have incredible power, and it doesn't take much. It's entirely possible I will see the city destroyed in my lifetime. That's a very interesting question, because there really has never been such a thing. Human beings are just naturally warlike creatures, it seems, if you go by the numbers. The United States has been at war for 220-some of its 230-some years. It's very difficult to say what world peace would be, because I'm not sure it can be achieved. If you're going to achieve it, you basically have to have a sense that people will be satisfied with what they have and not seek to take from those who have other things, which strikes me as a bit far-fetched.
Well, I guess the most obvious thing is that there's no war, right? So the sort of end of armed conflict. But even beyond war, it would be that people are treating each other humanely and respectfully in everyday life as well.
The goal of our project is to be so... The goal of our project is to lead a global social media campaign under the hashtag SAFE, Stop Atomic Fear Everywhere, to rally support from citizens of nuclear and non-nuclear states and put pressure globally on their leaders to promote nuclear disarmament and non-malicious uses for nuclear energy, resulting in amendments to the NPT that regulates nuclear affairs more strictly. The NPT has a solid base for a treaty, but needs something else to make the treaty more effective. The treaty opened for signatures in 1968, and the first review conference was held in May 1975. The review conference was to strengthen the treaty as much as possible to gain more signatures. Many states felt as though the treaty was one-sided, favoring the nuclear states over the non-nuclear states, by stating more rules for the non-nuclear states. Many questioned whether the nuclear states were taking every step to disarm. This question was asked at many future conferences.
There are many current obstacles. Nationalism and interest of power and security for one's own nation is a problem facing every agreement. Leaders of the charging nuclear weapons on each other. The Cold War and the U.S. Led to many bomb testing and keeping stockpile weapons near the opposing country. The U.S. stockpiles in Turkey and the Soviet Union had their weapons in Cuba, leading to the Cuban Missile Crisis. The Cuban Missile Crisis occurred when the Soviet Union stockpiled their weapons in Cuba. Much to the dismay of the United States, the U.S. responded by blockading Cuba and starting negotiations with the Soviet Union. This event ultimately ended in nuclear weapons leaving Turkey and Cuba, and showing that it was possible to negotiate between two very far countries that seek protection for themselves. Countries that distrust one another are less likely to disarm and agree to a treaty because they fear that the other country will not disarm. Distrust leads to back to the nuclear state's hesitation to sign into the treaty and abide by the rules of the treaty because they fear that the other country would attack when they are vulnerable and no longer armed. The formation of radical groups has challenges for the opposing side. Although the definition of radical group is up for interpretation, Madeline and I define it as a group of people with strong beliefs that attack others who do not have the same beliefs. Radical groups may take an interest in nuclear weapons to increase their strength in fighting. The opposing side may believe that nuclear weapons will be the quickest way to end a fight and consider it the possibility even knowing the effects of nuclear weapons.
Part one of our idea includes communication. Communication is an important part in creating a situation that works for all parties. A large part of this is attending the scheduled conferences. If a country doesn't attend, their voice won't be heard in any part of the treaty or in agreements made at the conferences. There have been a few conferences held that focus on the humanitarian aspect of abolishing nuclear weapons. The first conference, held in 2013 in Oslo, was a success and brought together many parties under the common goal of protecting civilization by abolishing nuclear weapons. Mexico held another humanitarian conference the next year. The countries that attended the Oslo conference also attended this conference, and many more countries joined in to learn about the humanitarian initiative. This conference was referred to being the point of no return because the push to abolish nuclear weapons, much like it did for biological and chemical weapons, was met with support from most participants. More conferences, like the two in Oslo and Mexico, are being scheduled and are making headway in abolishing nuclear weapons. The nuclear states did not participate in the first two conferences. In the most recent conference in Vienna, the US and the UK attended. This is a large step towards the abolition of nuclear weapons. The treatment of countries in regards to the following rules should be equal among all. The first NPT review conference, non-nuclear states pointed out that many rules for their countries and a few rules and regulations for nuclear states is unfair and won't get good reviews from either side in the long run. The rules should be clear and enforced equally among all countries, whether they have nuclear weapons, have had nuclear weapons, or currently have nuclear weapons.
Part two of our idea involves using power of social media and bringing attention to nuclear affairs and disarmament. Using the hashtag SAFE, nuclear affairs can be spread to every country in the world in a matter of hours simply by people using the hashtag on their Facebooks, Twitters, Tumblrs, Instagrams, and so many other social media. An excellent example of this power in media is hashtag Connie 2012. This hashtag started trending after a documentary featured the injustices done by Joseph Connie, an African cult militant leader, went viral when the hashtag and the documentary spread all throughout the world and led to Connie's arrest in the end of 2012. We just want to show that social media can bring a change. Other hashtags have promoted change, including hashtag Black Lives Matter and hashtag $40, which hashtag $40 was something that President Obama started trending to show that what would happen, that $40 would be taken out of normal civilians' paychecks if Republicans had their way. The hashtag SAFE will show solidarity throughout the entire world that cannot be ignored
The five nuclear states, Russia, China, the UK, the US, and France, will be required to set an example by following a 25% stockpile reduction rate every 3 years. If the nuclear states, or any other states, choose not to follow the obligations put forth by the treaty, sanctions will be given out. Sanctions can include receiving no help from the United Nations and related agencies, and reducing the chance to host an international competition, such as the Olympics or the World Cup, that help the economic growth of the country. With that, any country that wishes to negotiate to provide their signature may do so to make their country satisfied with the arrangements created by the treaty.
The final part of our idea is to begin complete planning creation of nuclear weapons, 430 bombs, which are made of nuclear waste from fusile materials. Once nuclear weapons are banned, non-nuclear nations who no longer want nuclear weapons can begin to pressure nuclear states to disarm. With large-scale disarmament, we can begin to negotiate with countries such as Israel, Pakistan, India, and North Korea.
With persistence, these parts will rid the world of nuclear weapons. Communication between countries with an increased public awareness using #Safe, countries taking action within themselves and other countries, and the prevention of nuclear weapons in the future will rid the world of nuclear threats. Nuclear nonproliferation is a movement that will need the support and work of many to become a reality all over the world. We need the public's help to get the movement started and bring attention to the status of nuclear weapons.
On behalf of our school and ourselves, thank you for listening to our presentation.
Are there any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you for the interesting presentation. I just have one question. During your plan, you talked about like if the countries like refuse to disarm, like you'll place sanctions on them. But for example, China, like 84% of all factories in China are owned by companies from other nations. So how would you mitigate the threat of doing harm to your own country by putting sanctions on the nuclear countries that don't cooperate?
There's such a sanctions goal as boycotting companies, certain companies that do go abroad. We can't really put restrictions on what they do in other countries, but we can boycott them and their business to hurt their gains and push them to make a change.
Yeah, and that's where hosting international competition comes in, because Beijing did hold the Olympics, and the Olympics was a huge economic boost to China. And because it brings in many people from all over the world to their country. And if they are not in the running to host these competitions, they cannot get the benefits included with these competitions.
Thank you.
Do we have any other questions?
We've been applying sanctions against Iran for decades now, and I don't think they've been as effective as we hoped. Do you think that, or the sanctions that you propose, would they be stricter, or is there anything else you propose to discourage countries from developing nuclear weapons?
Yes, I think that if more countries or more nuclear states would sit down to talk to Iran, maybe more negotiations could be peddled out, such as the United States right now with Iran.
And the sanctions that we put forth as ideas are just a starting point. We understand that many people have many different ideas from all over the world, and maybe they'll have an idea that will be effective with countries such as Iran that are not maybe listening to the current sanctions.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your really interesting presentation and the really cool hashtag. I just have a really quick question. First off, would your plan and your resolution be enacted through an international body like the UN or NATO? And if so, how do you plan to get nuclear countries and countries that might be necessarily dependent on those countries to sign on and support it if there's a vested economic loss that they will incur if they support your plan. Thank you.
All right. Starting with the UN question. The UN will be asked to speak largely and enforcing and pressuring other countries, especially the five nuclear states, the US and other countries like it, who are very successful and not many sanctions can be applied. Work from the grassroots, such as #safe, will be in place so that the people and common civilians will pressure their leaders to make change.
Thank you. If there's no more questions, I would like to thank you for watching our presentation.